Now. Welcome to church. We are so glad that you're here with us today, live streaming from wherever you're at to wherever we're at. God is on the move, and we're glad that you're at worship today. Hey, if you're new today, if you're streaming from some other place, we'd love to connect with you. Text NEW to FCLC to the code 97000 and we can connect. Or a lot of people have been really blessed by downloading our Church Center app, which gets you connected in many other ways as well, not just to the church, but also to daily announcements and things that are going on. If you put that app together and you register for that, you'll be caught up on everything that's going on, and we'd be glad to connect with you in that way as well. Today's theme is digging ourselves into a hole. If any of you have ever been in the situation where you dug yourself into a hole, you know that you need an intercessor, somebody to come and help get you out. Pastor Craig today is going to be talking about how we have an intercessor, not just someone who comes down to us, but also somebody who makes atonement for us in Christ. And so that's our theme. I hope that you're ready to learn from God's word and be prepared to share that. Speaking of sharing it, if you take a picture of yourself during this live stream worship and put it on your social media, it's a real fun way to let people know that you were at church today and you heard some good news. So take some good notes, take a picture of yourself, post it on your social media, and give people the hope that you found in Jesus here today. All right, so now worship begins with the singing of our first song.
Good morning again, everybody, and welcome to worship. We're so delighted that you're joining us today from wherever you're at. You know, God's people have always put things in place of Him on the throne, and His people of the Old Testament were no different. We've been walking through the book of Exodus in our journey through Lent, and we dig into it today and see just what happens when somebody other than Jesus is the King of Kings in our life. From Exodus chapter 32, verses 1 through 14, when the people saw that Moses was so long in coming down from the mountain, they gathered around Aaron and said, "Come, make us gods who will go before us. As for this fellow Moses who brought us up out of Egypt, we don't know what has happened to him."
Aaron answered them, "Take off the gold earrings that your wives, your sons, and your daughters are wearing, and bring them to me." So all the people took off their earrings and brought them to Aaron. He took what they had handed them and made it into an idol cast in the shape of a calf, fashioning it with a tool. Then they said, "These are your gods, Israel, who brought you up out of Egypt."
When Aaron saw this, he built an altar in front of the calf and announced, "Tomorrow there will be a festival to the Lord." So the next day, the people rose early and sacrificed burnt offerings and presented fellowship offerings. Afterward, they sat down to eat and drink and got up to indulge in revelry.
Then the Lord said to Moses, "Go down, because your people, whom you brought up out of Egypt, have become corrupt. They have been quick to turn away from what I commanded them and have made themselves an idol cast in the shape of a calf. They have bowed down to it and sacrificed to it and have said, 'These are your gods, Israel, who brought you up out of Egypt.'"
"I have seen these people," the Lord said to Moses, "and they are a stiff-necked people. Now leave me alone so that my anger may burn against them and that I may destroy them. Then I will make you into a great nation."
But Moses sought the favor of the Lord his God. "Lord," he said, "why should your anger burn against your people, whom you have brought out of Egypt with great power and a mighty hand? Why should the Egyptians say, 'It was the evil intent that he brought them out, to kill them in the mountains and to wipe them off the face of the earth'? Turn from your fierce anger, relent, and do not bring disaster on your people. Remember your servants, Abraham, Isaac, and Israel, to whom you swore by your own self, 'I will make your descendants as numerous as the stars in the sky, and I will give your descendants all this land I promised them, and it will be their inheritance forever.'" Then the Lord relented and did not bring on his people the disaster he had threatened.
There is only one King of Kings, and we invite you to sing with us now as we worship him.
From heaven you came running, there was mercy in your eyes. kings, to reveal the kingdom coming and to reconcile the lost, to redeem the whole creation. You did not despise the cross, for even in your suffering you saw through the other side, knowing this was our salvation. Jesus, for our sake you died. Praise the Father, praise the Son, praise the Spirit, three in one. God of glory, majesty, praise forever to the King of Kings. And the moment that you rose, all of heaven held its breath, till that stone was moved for good, for the Lamb had conquered death. And the dead rose from their tombs, and the angels stood in awe, for the souls of all who'd come to the Father are restored. And the Church of Christ was born, then the Spirit lit the flame. Now this gospel truth of old shall not kneel, shall not faint. By His blood and in His name, in His freedom I am free. For the love of Jesus Christ, who has resurrected me.
Let us pray. Lord God, for strength in these days, for an extra measure of your grace, for the intercession of your Holy Spirit, for the atonement that we need for our sins, and for your mighty deliverance, we praise you and we thank you. And we pray that you would bless our worship this day. In Jesus' name, amen. The first reading from 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verses 11 through 13, speaking of the Israelites, it says, "These things happened to them as examples and are written down as warnings for us, on whom the culmination of the ages has come. So if you think you are standing firm, be careful that you don't fall. No temptation has overtaken you except what is common to mankind, and God is faithful. He will not let you be tempted beyond what you can bear. But when you are tempted, He will also provide a way out so that you can endure it." Now, the worship service is meant to be interactive, and so wherever you're at today, whether you're on your couch or at your home, if you are able, we invite you to stand for the reading of the Holy Gospel. We stand because of the resurrection promises that we receive in Jesus. Listen to what Jesus says in Matthew 26. "Watch and pray that you will not fall into temptation. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak. This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ." Please be seated.
I invite you to join me in prayer as we begin. Lord Jesus, when we dig ourselves into a hole of sin, we thank you for your willingness to constantly reach down and lift us up again. Amen. Have you ever found yourself stuck in the sand or the mud? I mean, like really stuck, like what's on that picture? It can happen very easily. All you have to do is take a wrong turn, and before you know it, you can find yourself sinking deeper and deeper and deeper. What's the natural response when that starts to happen? You hit the accelerator. You put the pedal to the metal, hoping you can get out. And if that doesn't work, you do it again. And before you know it, you've dug yourself even deeper into a hole so deep, you are so stuck that there is no way you're going to get yourself out. I experienced that one time on a mission trip in Liberia. Our team was heading to a church one Sunday morning, and we prepared to drive through what we thought was a mud puddle. But when we got into it, we discovered it was something much bigger and much deeper. And the more the driver tried to get us out of that puddle, the deeper and deeper we sunk. Thankfully, some villagers saw our predicament, and they came running to rescue us. They jumped into the mud hole, and they began to push the vehicle. And between the driver and these villagers, eventually the vehicle got out of the mud. Not before the vehicle and the villages were literally covered in mud, though. But the villagers didn't seem to mind. As we left waving, they were rejoicing because they had rescued us from being stuck. Have you ever found yourself that stuck in mud or sand that you couldn't get yourself out, that someone else needed to rescue you? For those of you who maybe grew up further north, it wasn't mud or sand, it was snow. You know what it's like to get stuck in snow. And it can be a helpless feeling, but more than that, it can be dangerous and even deadly, especially if you're stuck in a blizzard or when the temperatures are bitter cold. Well, today as we continue our sermon series based on the book of Exodus, we find that Aaron, Moses' older brother, gets himself in a deep, deep hole. First, Aaron takes a wrong turn, and then he gets himself stuck, and then he stomps on the accelerator where he absolutely buries himself and the Israelites in a deep hole. And this is also tragic because God had appointed Aaron and his sons to be priests, to be spiritual leaders of the people of God. While Moses was on the mountaintop with God, Aaron was responsible for the people down below. And it's so tragic because of the promise that God's people had made to God. After God had led the Israelites out of their slavery in Egypt to the mountain of the Lord, God told Moses to order the Israelites to stay down at the base of the mountain. And then God descended onto the mountaintop where he gave Moses the Ten Commandments to share with his people. Listen to how Exodus 19 describes this event. There was thunder and lightning with a thick cloud over the mountain and a very loud trumpet blast. Everyone in the camp trembled. Then Moses led the people out of the camp to meet with God, and they stood at the foot of the mountain. Mount Sinai was covered with smoke because the Lord descended on it in fire. The smoke billowed up from it like smoke from a furnace, and the whole mountain trembled violently. As the sound of the trumpet grew louder and louder, Moses spoke, and the voice of God answered him. So just as God had displayed his mighty power when he brought plagues on Egypt and rescued the Israelites from their slavery in Egypt, just as God had displayed his almighty power when he parted the Red Sea so that the Israelites could pass through on dry ground and then the Egyptian soldiers could be drowned, so God is displaying his almighty power on top of Mount Sinai. The Israelites had no reason to wonder if their almighty God was still with them. They could see his glorious presence right there on top of the mountain. Well, God invited Moses up that mountain. There on the mountaintop, God wanted to give Moses the Ten Commandments along with other laws that would make up the Book of the Covenant. And then God sent Moses down to the people to tell them the words and the laws of the Lord. And with one voice, this is how the Israelites responded. Everything the Lord has said, we will do. So far, so good. God's covenant people agreed to obey the God who had rescued them and claimed them to be his treasured possession. Well, then God called Moses back up to the mountain to give him the tablets of stone that had the laws and the commands written on them. And God also wanted to spend some time with Moses, instructing him on how the children of Israel were to worship. So Moses went back up on the mountain. And then this is what we find happened. When Moses went up on the mountain, the cloud covered it, and the glory of the Lord settled on Mount Sinai. For 6 days the cloud covered the mountain, and on the seventh day the Lord called to Moses from within the cloud. To the Israelites, the glory of the Lord looked like a consuming fire on top of the mountain. Then Moses entered the cloud as he went up into the mountain, and he stayed on the mountain 40 days and 40 nights. You've heard those words, 40 days and 40 nights, in other places of Scripture. Throughout Scripture, a 40-day period is often a time of testing to see if God's people are going to trust and obey Him as the one true God. For 40 days and 40 nights, it rained on Noah and his family in the ark. For 40 days, the spies that Moses sent into Canaan explored their future home. For 40 days, the Philistine giant Goliath challenged the army of Israel to send out a soldier to fight him. For 40 days and 40 nights, Elijah journeyed to the mountain of the Lord. And for 40 days and 40 nights, Jesus fasted in the wilderness and was tempted by Satan. I wonder if our world is going through its own period of 40 days and 40 nights to see if we will trust and obey God. Well, as you heard in the account today in Exodus, the Israelites failed this 40-day test miserably. Once they hit that 40-day mark and Moses still hadn't come down from the mountain, they decided they could wait no longer. It was time to take things into their own hands. When the people saw how long it was taking Moses to come back down the mountain, they gathered around Aaron and said, "Come on, make us some gods who can lead us. We don't know what happened to this fellow Moses who brought us here from the land of Egypt." Moses had been on top of Mount Sinai for 40 days and 40 nights, and the people could wait no longer. How long do we have to wait? You and I know that feeling, especially now. How long will I be quarantined? How long will I be without work? How long before there's a cure to the coronavirus? How long will the economy be on a roller coaster ride? How long before I can give my kids back to their teachers once again? How long? Like the Israelites, we don't like to have a God who makes us wait. We want a God who's right here, right now for us, to give us the things we want. And this is where Aaron takes a wrong turn. Aaron said to the Israelites, "Take off the gold earrings that your wives, your sons, and your daughters are wearing and bring them to me." So all the people took off their earrings and brought them to Aaron. He took what they handed him and made it into an idol cast in the shape of a calf, fashioning it with a tool. Then they said, "These are your gods, Israel, who brought you up out of Egypt." Just like that, the Israelites had exchanged the one true God for an idol in the form of a calf. And they gave the calf the credit for delivering them from Egypt. They said, "Move over, God. We've got a replacement for you." Aaron and the people knew what God had commanded them to do and not to do. God said in Exodus 20, "I am the Lord your God who brought you out of Egypt, out of the land of slavery. You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make for yourself an image in the form of anything in heaven above, or on the earth beneath, or in the waters below. You shall not bow down to them or worship them." Aaron and the children of Israel knew what they weren't supposed to do, and they promised that they would follow and obey God. But in a moment of weakness, the Israelites and their leader Aaron at the time took a wrong turn, and Aaron made a golden calf. Have you ever taken a wrong turn in your life in a moment of weakness? Have you known something was wrong, but you chose to do it anyway? Have you ever replaced the true God with an idol of your own making? If we're honest with ourselves, we're more like Aaron than we care to admit. Well, when the Israelites saw the golden calf Aaron had made, they were overjoyed. They had a God of their own making in their very presence. No more waiting for that God on the mountaintop to come back down. Now, it wasn't too late at this point for Aaron to make a course correction. It wasn't too late for Aaron to turn the people back to the one true God, but he didn't. Not only did he take a wrong turn, he got himself and the Israelites stuck. When Aaron saw this, he built an altar in front of the calf and announced, "Tomorrow there will be a festival to the Lord." Aaron made a stunning claim. Aaron calls the calf the Lord. He's compromising to please the people. He's built an altar in front of the calf that he made, and then he announces that there's going to be a festival to the Lord. It's like he's thinking, well, somehow if I can still just keep the Lord in the picture, everything will be okay. Have you ever done what Aaron did? Do you ever worship other things but keep the Lord just enough in the picture to ease your conscience and justify your words or your actions? Do you ever try to turn God into a Democrat or a Republican? Do you ever claim that God belongs only to your country and that he's not the God of all nations? Do you ever say you believe God, but you don't believe what God is telling you to do? Do you ever treat the Ten Commandments as God's ten suggestions? If we're honest with ourselves, we're more like Aaron than we care to admit. Aaron's really stuck now, but he doesn't realize how stuck until the next day. The next day, the people rose early and they sacrificed burnt offerings and presented fellowship offerings. Afterward, they sat down to eat and drink and got up to indulge in revelry. Aaron was maybe relieved when he saw their first actions. They sacrificed burnt offerings and presented fellowship offerings, something that they were used to doing as they worshiped the one true God. But when Aaron saw what the Israelites did next, he realized just how deep he and the Israelites were digging themselves into a hole. They sat down to eat and drink, and they got up to indulge in revelry. In other words, what they did is what you do when you worship a pagan god. You carry out pagan practices. Remember the Ten Commandments that the Israelites all said that they were going to obey? Well, they were pretty much breaking all of them at that point. The Israelites would have felt right at home in Sin City. To say that the Lord was outraged is an understatement. After all he had done to save them, this is the thanks he gets. God disowned the Israelites and he was ready to destroy them for their idolatry. But this is when Moses steps in and intercedes on their behalf. God, these are the people you delivered. God, remember your covenant promise to Abraham and Isaac and Jacob? You promised to make their descendants as numerous as the stars in the sky, and you promised to give them a land that they could settle in as their inheritance. God, your people have broken their covenant promise, but you're the God who keeps your covenant promise. You see what Moses is doing here? He's quoting God's covenant promises to God. Not because God couldn't remember his covenant promises, but because Moses trusted that God was a God who would keep his covenant promises. Well, with that, God sends Moses down the mountainside, and before Moses even got to the base of the mountain, he saw why God was so angry with the Israelites. Moses took those stone tablets and he smashed them against the base of the mountain. And then he took that calf made of wood and gold and he burned it up, and then he ground it down into powder, scattered it on the water, and then he made the Israelites drink that water. So much for their God. At that point, you could say that the Israelites were officially decaffeinated. Well, then Moses turned to his brother Aaron, and Aaron knew he had really dug himself and the Israelites into a deep, deep hole. He said, "What did these people do to you that you led them into such great sin?" And at this point, Aaron stomps on the accelerator, trying to get unstuck. He says, "Do not be angry, my Lord. You know how prone these people are to evil. Make us gods who will go before us," they said. "As for this fellow Moses who brought us out of Egypt, we don't know what's happened to him." So I told them, "Whoever has any gold jewelry, take it off." Then they gave me the gold and I threw it into the fire and poof, out came this calf. Do you see what Aaron does when he's confronted with his sin? He blames the evil Israelites who told him to do it. And then he says the golden calf just magically appeared. Aaron shows that he's definitely related to Adam and Eve. He takes no responsibility for his sin and his disobedience. Instead, he blames others and he lies about how things happened. Well, at this point, Aaron has dug himself and the Israelites into a deep, deep hole. And there is no way they're going to get out of it. And that day, about 3,000 Israelites were struck down and died because of their idolatry. The next day, Moses came out to the Israelites and he said, "You've committed a great sin. But now I will go up to the Lord. Perhaps I can make atonement for your sin." It was a great sin because of where they committed it, at Mount Sinai, God's holy mountain. It was a great sin because of when they committed it, after God had delivered them from their slavery in Egypt and brought them to the place where they were to worship him. How many of you, if you were Moses, would have just washed your hands of the whole situation and just left that bunch behind? How many of you would have said, "God, they're all yours. Do what you want with them. But first, let me get some social distance before you destroy them"? No one would have blamed Moses, but that's not what Moses did. Instead, Moses interceded for the Israelites, and he wanted to make atonement for their sins. Unlike Aaron, who wanted to shift the blame for his sin to someone else, Moses was willing to shift the blame of the Israelites to himself. Moses interceded on their behalf, and he was willing to make atonement for their sin. And atonement for their sin is what they needed. Atonement for their sin was the only hope that would get them out of their hole of sin. But Moses could not be the one to make that atonement for sin. The job of atoning for sin would be left for another. The job of atoning for sin would be left for Jesus. We need that atoning for sin as much as Aaron and the Israelites did. We've all made our own gods to replace the one true God. Maybe those gods have changed some since the coronavirus crisis began. Maybe before the coronavirus, our gods were affluence, work, entertainment, sports teams, vacations, popularity. Maybe now our gods are economic stimulus package, a vaccine, shopping, or an addiction. Remember last week when I said that your gods, whatever you place your identity, security, and meaning in, whatever those gods are, they can never replace the one true God. When God says in his first commandment, "You shall have no other gods before me," he's not just making a commandment, he's making a promise. You can try to have other gods before me, but they are not going to work. Eventually, they're going to fail you. The coronavirus crisis has shown us how quickly our gods can be grounded into powder and scattered on the water. Only one God can save us, and he has saved us through his Son. For all the times we've taken a wrong turn, for all the times we've gotten stuck, for all the times we've buried ourselves in a hole of sin, Jesus has reached down to us and he's rescued us with his forgiveness. He is the Almighty God who has saved us through his death on the cross and his victorious resurrection from the dead. And if he was willing to do that to take care of our eternal needs, you can trust in him to take care of your earthly needs as well. You can trust him to pull you out of the holes that you are in. You can claim God's covenant promises just like Moses did. You can remember that God's covenant with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob is an everlasting covenant that is sealed in blood. Sin can't break that covenant. Idolatry can't nullify that covenant. Death can't defeat that covenant. And a huge hole cannot swallow up that covenant. That's because the covenant that God made with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob was fulfilled in the death of Jesus. God's covenant promises are sealed forever in Jesus' blood shed for you and me and the world on the cross. Just like the Liberian villagers who got our vehicle out of the mud were willing to have mud and filth thrown on them in the process, so Jesus was willing to have all the filth of our sin thrown on him on the cross so that he could get us out of our hole of sin. And in baptism, God has connected us to Christ's saving work, washing our sins away and making us his covenant people. So the next time you find yourselves digging yourself into a hole, remember, claim the covenant promises of God and experience how he lifts you up once again. In Jesus' name, amen. At this time, as we prepare to worship the Lord with our offerings, we turn to God's word to guide us and how we give gifts that are meaningful to the Lord. And today we're reminded that an offering that pleases God is given regularly and proportionately. Let's please read together from 1 Corinthians chapter 16, verse 2. On the first day of every week, each one of you should set aside a sum of money in keeping with your income. Now, obviously, since we're now worshiping online, our practice of offering has changed. And before I talk to you about different ways that you can give your offering, I want to speak first to those of you who are members of other churches. I want to encourage you to continue supporting your church because your church needs your support now, maybe more than ever before. And for those of you who are members of our church, I pray that you will think about the words that we just read from Scripture as you continue to give regularly as you have and in proportion to the way that God has blessed you. Some of you have been giving by sending your offerings in the mail or by dropping them off at the church office. There are also online ways for giving offerings. One is through our website, faithlasvegas.org, or you can give through the mobile app, the Church Center app, as you just hit give and enter the amount on the bottom of the screen. Or you can text to give and just text your amount to the number you see on the screen. May God bless our time of worship now as we provide our offerings for Him.
My refuge in the storm. And through these trials, you've always been faithful. You bring healing to my soul.
Stand as you're able for prayer. Lord God, you are God alone. There's no other God besides you, but we confess that at times we try to fashion and form you into a God of our making. When we grow impatient with you, when we don't see that you are present and working for our benefit, we are tempted to replace you with gods that we have made, which are no gods at all. When we do, we fall even further away from you. God, we know what we deserve. We deserve your judgment now and forever. Thank you for not giving us what we deserve. Thank you for giving us what we need, your forgiveness. Help us to trust that you are faithful to us because of the covenant you made with us in baptism. And help us to worship and trust and obey you alone. Amen. I invite you to be seated. We have a couple announcements this morning. First of all, the Balm of Gilead food drive will continue Monday, Wednesday, and Friday mornings from 9 to noon. We appreciate those who have contributed this past week and encourage others to join in that as well. We also have a Prayer Connection Zoom meetings, and they take place on Wednesday evenings at 6 p.m. I encourage you to connect in that way as well. Also want to be grateful to those who have sewed face masks for health workers, and if you're so inclined to participate in that ministry, we encourage you to do so. And Holy Week and Easter are coming up quickly. We will follow the normal Holy Week and Easter schedule. It'll be online, and more details will come out about that in the near future, as in this next week. And for information about that and any information about what we're doing here at Faith, I encourage you to go to our website, and that'll help you out there. And now join me as we close with prayer. Lord God, Heavenly Father, we thank and praise you for the grace shown us in Christ Jesus our Lord. Confident that we are your children now and forever, we humbly ask for your presence and your providence during our current crisis. We pray for our homes. Bring peace and tranquility where there is strife and panic. Assuage the fears of our children. Bless their parents with calm guidance and support that they may be reflections of your patience and care. May they be conduits of your mercy and strength. Keep unhealthy indulgence at bay, that people may refrain from domestic violence and abuse, but rather model restraint and respect. We pray for our elderly. Let them not be abandoned or even feel abandoned, but that due respect and care be given them. Keep them from loneliness, using the ministry of the presence of your people as a reminder that you are our good shepherd. We pray for the unemployed. Let them not be paralyzed or agitated by fear, but give them hope of employment and promise of provision. Where there is need, use us to fill it. We pray for our community. Help us to treat each other as fellow human beings and creations of yours, and not simply means to our ends. Bring an end to hoarding and grant us a spirit of giving rather than taking, that we might be an honest reflection of your selflessness. We pray for our leaders. Grant them wisdom and the ability to govern in such a way that inspires confidence and trust. Continue to bless those on the front lines, doctors, nurses, and first responders. Grant them energy to continue to be your vehicles of healing and hope. Confident in your care, help us as a congregation to care, and in so doing, be gentle instruments to invite others to know your Son, Jesus, who sacrificed himself for our sakes and for our salvation. Let the glory of his resurrection inspire us in our time of need. In grateful trust, we approach your throne of mercy. Amen. Gathered in the name of Jesus, we are bold to pray the prayer he has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. And I receive the blessing of our Lord. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen.
One God, one Savior, one provider for every need we could possibly have in every season we are walking through. We invite you to sing with us now as we sing of Jesus, our cornerstone.
Name. My hope is built
on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name. Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior's love. Through the storm, He is Lord, Lord of all. When darkness seems to hide His face, I rest on His unchanging grace. Through every veil, my anchor holds within the veil. Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior's love. Through the storm, He is Lord, Lord. Dressed in His righteousness alone, faultless stand before the throne.
Most of us aren't going very many places this week. If you're blessed enough to be able to go to work, go in His peace there. If you're going to the grocery store, go in His peace there. If the biggest journey you take this week is walking from one room of your house to another, go in His peace, and may our eyes be open on how we can serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.
All right.